We've been talking about the first angel's message, and I'm sure because of our somewhat limited time factor today, we're going to be talking about next week also. Although this is the last main section that I'm going to be talking about in this particular series on them. And as we mentioned in the very beginning, God will be God. He must be God, and his character demands that he acts and reacts in a manner that is consistent with his love. We noted that as we come near the end of time, the Bible, and particularly the book of Revelation, it portrays a scene of evil against good, a final showdown, as it were, between the forces of righteousness and all the forces of wickedness, between those who will stand under the blood-stained banner of Prince Emmanuel and those who will, as it were, follow after Satan and his ways. They will accept the mark of the beast and finally be lost. And great events are transpiring and ready to transpire right now before us. I'm going to talk to you for just a minute about a Greek word, kairos. Kairos. And this word means, it's an ancient Greek word meaning the right, critical, or opportune moment. The ancient Greeks had two words for time, chronos and kairos. While the former refers to chronological or sequential time, the latter signifies a proper or opportune time for action. Now, there's going to be a meeting this week, starting in just a couple days, or maybe even tomorrow. I'm not sure which the date was. But it's called Kairos 2017. And this is going to be held in Kansas City. And it's going to be a revival or unity, ecumenical unity. It says celebrating a year of destiny. They're saying that this year is a year of destiny. And they say, for instance, it's the 40th year anniversary of the Ecumenical Charismatic Conference held in Kansas City in 1977. That was a big meeting held in Arrowhead Stadium. 50 plus thousand people were there. It is the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, dating it from 1517, the 50-year anniversary of the Catholic Charismatic Renewal that happened at Duquesne College in Pittsburgh, and it's the 50th-year anniversary of the Messianic Movement of 1967. It's also the 50th anniversary of the war between Israel and Egypt. Interesting, when Jerusalem was taken back by Israel. And these people are coming together, and they're going to have a pretty big powwow, and it's pretty big people. For instance, Cardinal Daniel Denario is going to be there as one of the keynote speakers. This is a Jesuit-trained man who also studied at the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. Kenneth Copeland will be there. Everybody's heard of Kenneth Copeland and his charismatic ways. This conference has endorsements, for instance, from the Archbishop of Kansas City, of the Diocese of Kansas City, and other people of the Catholic faith that are supposed to be Orthodox people there as well, represented. And so it's going to be quite a meeting. In fact, and they note this on their website. They said, the meeting of Kairos cannot be considered a simple ecumenical event among many, but it should be considered a new ecumenical Pentecost. So they're expecting great big things to happen. And we know that in the Bible, whether this is an event that's really going to propel things forward in a large way or just be a piece of the puzzle, we know that in the end, according to what the Bible prophecy is, that all of these religions are going to come together. And they're going to unite. But friends, they're going to unite on what the Pope says. They're going to unite on the beast of Revelation 13. Don't think any other way.
That's right.
But we have a message. We have a message based in Revelation chapter 14. That's what we've been talking about the last few weeks. It's called the three angels' messages because there are three different angels that each has a successive message after the other that is to prepare this world for these final events, to help a people to be prepared to stand for the last great movements.
Yeah.
And Revelation chapter 14, reading again verse 6 and 7, "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell in the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come." In the last 2 weeks, we discussed the time prophecy of Daniel 8:14. We showed you on the timeline how that prophecy has a fulfillment that came to pass in exactly October 22, 1844. And by the way, today's October 21, just a day off the anniversary of that date. And interestingly, just as a side note, James Usher, remember James Usher, the archbishop that did all the chronology a few hundred years ago? He came to the conclusion that this earth came into existence in 4,000, what we would today date 4,004 B.C., right? Do you know what day in 4,004 B.C.? He said the evening of October 22. Interesting, isn't it? But this message is not only to fear God and give glory to him because his hour of judgment has come, but it's a message also to worship him that made heaven and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. It is a message to give glory to God and to worship him as the Creator God. Now, while the command to fear God at first might sound as though God wishes for us to cower in fright of him, the word fear in the Bible also means to show reverence, to have a healthy respect and honor for. And that being said, a healthy fear and respect of God is important, for we must remember that he is the author of all things, and we are his creatures, friends. Despite what common scientists says, I saw a headline on a video recently, and it said, "How we proved evolution was true." I assure you, evolution has never been proven true. Amen. People have been deceived, people have been misled or misunderstood, but evolution is a false idea of Satan. And even the people who try to mix the Bible and evolution and come up with an idea called theistic evolution are greatly misled, friends, because it denies what the very Word of God says. And we need to believe what the Word of God says. Now, how can we reverence or give glory to God or worship him properly if we do not know him properly? And as we noted in an earlier session, that a proper knowledge of God is the essential preparation for both this life and for the life to come. Furthermore, we are told in Romans chapter 3 and verse 23 that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Isn't that right? You see, there's a cause and effect there. Sin brings us short of the glory of God. So, what would obedience therefore then bring? It would bring us to the glory of God. It would help us to glorify God by bringing obedience to him. In volume A of the Testimonies on page 139, it says, "It is the manifestation of this love that brings glory to God in the highest on earth, peace, goodwill toward men." This manifestation of God's great love in giving his Son, and love demonstrated in obedience. Love is demonstrated in obedience. Jesus said in John chapter 14, 15, "If you love me, you can do anything you want."
No.
He didn't say that? What did he say?
Keep his commandments.
He says, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." You will keep my commandments. It's a cause and effect thing. Now, in Acts chapter 24, and we just look at some of these verses. I know we're familiar with a few of them. But in Acts chapter 24, and I could quote the verse very quickly, but I want you to open your Bibles too and use your Bible. It speaks about Paul here when he's speaking before Felix. Acts chapter 24, verse 25. "And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled." He spoke about a judgment to come. But our message today, friends, our message today is that the hour of his judgment has come. It is come. It is now here among us. It's not something that is in the future. It is now. The judgment time when the final atonement was begun has been connected accurately with the 2300 days of Daniel 8:14. And we've been told that the scripture, which above all others had been both the foundation, central pillar of the Advent faith, was the declaration on the 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Great Controversy, page 409. We studied the prophecy of Daniel 8:14 in the last 2 weeks. And for those of you who weren't here, you want to get the tape later when we get the tape finished. But there we found out that that prophecy began in 457 BC and extended down to, in fact, October 22 of 1844. That was the time that the Day of Atonement occurred in 1844. And after that time, there was a great disappointment because those people were expecting Jesus to come. They understood the timing right, but they had some of the events wrong. They thought Jesus was going to come. He was going to cleanse the earth, which they thought was the sanctuary, by fire. And it didn't happen. And many were sorely disappointed. And they began to seek for guidance. And God revealed to Hiram Edson that something great indeed did happen on October 22. It wasn't the coming of Jesus to this earth as they had thought, but rather it was the movement of Christ from the holy to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. Amen. Now, the common evangelical understanding of the atonement, the understanding that's going to be preached in Kansas City, for example, and perhaps even in churches today. When I say today, I'm not talking about time generically. I'm talking about today. So you get what I mean? The idea of the atonement is that everything that was necessary for the salvation of man was finished at the cross. But friends, this is a deception of Satan. You know, Paul, for example, he says that if Christ is not raised from the dead, then our faith is in vain. Was the plan of salvation complete at the cross? No, it could not have been. Now, was the sacrifice complete? Yes. Yes. Was the sacrifice perfect? Absolutely. Cannot add to it or take away from it in any way. But there must be a resurrection. And further, there must be an ascension. And then there must be administration of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary. This is all part of God's work. It's the deception of Satan to teach that the atonement was finished and complete at the cross. It takes people's minds off of the final atonement and its work of cleansing the people and the vindication of the character of God. Now, on the Day of Atonement, there were three areas of the sanctuary for which atonement was made. And you can read about it in Leviticus chapter 16. The most holy place an atonement was made for it, and that was where the very presence of God was to reside. This work for heaven and for heavenly places represents glorification. The work in the holy place represented sanctification, living without sin. And the atonement at the brazen altar represented the cross, and it represents the work of justification. And most professed Christians today only believe in the work of justification. They think justification is all we need. Even in Adventism, we are told that our goal, that which we reach toward, is sinless living, but that it can never be reached until Jesus comes. Oh yes, it's good to have that as a goal. It's good to have that as a desire. We shouldn't want to sin. We should try not to sin. But it's not going to happen until Jesus comes. That's a popular teaching. But it's not the teaching of the Bible. In 1844, words were addressed to the Philadelphia church, found in Revelation chapter 3. And let's turn there. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, "These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name." Now, prophetically, it has been the history of many of our people for a long time to teach that this represented the time just prior to 1844. But that wasn't the way the early Adventists saw it. It's not the way the Bible presents it, neither is the way the Spirit of Prophecy presents it. Because you notice it says, I've set before thee, this church, an open door. That open door wasn't presented before 1844, friends. It was presented after 1844. The one holding the key of David opens the door to the heavenly, most holy place, and no one can shut that door from believers, no matter how much they might wish to try. Jesus said that he has shut a door, and no man can open it. And so what we have here is we have a system today in this world, a system that's been set up by Satan, that tries to open one door that's been shut and shut another door that's been opened. Do you get it? In other words, a door that represented to the people their justification, Satan wants that to be the only thing they see. In other words, Satan is content if you have a sin and repent, sin and repent, sin and repent program. That's okay with Satan, because you're going to keep sinning. But Jesus wants you to trust and obey, because, friends, there is no other way. Men may try to live a holy place, justification-only life, but Jesus says it will not happen. We need to understand that sanctification, in other words, the cleansing that is represented by the most holy place, is the standard in the time of the final atonement, and not justification or forgiveness represented by the holy place alone. Now, the first angel's message that we read in Revelation 14, verse 7, it ends with a command to worship God as the Creator. We acknowledge God as the Creator in two ways. Firstly, we worship Him as the Creator of heaven and earth, the most logical way. And this, friends, is symbolized. It is typified, if you would, and even much more than that, by the keeping of the seventh-day Sabbath, because the Sabbath is a memorial of His creative work. But secondly, we worship Him as the Creator through redemption, because redemption is a creative process. As the Creator of heaven and earth, God is worthy of our worship. In Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11, it says, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created." We know that in 6 days, God created the heaven and the earth. And He did all this through Jesus Christ. Genesis 1, 2, and John 1, 3. By His creative word, God made all things. And if you were in my Sabbath school class, you got this verse earlier, but we're going to go to it again for those who weren't. And that's in Psalms 33. Psalms 33, verses 6 and 9. He says, "By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of His mouth." Verse 9. "For He spake, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast." When God said in Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, it's when it said that God said, "Let there be light," what immediately happened? There was light. When God speaks, friends, things happen. And the Sabbath is a memorial of His speaking of creation and of God's power to create. Genesis 2, 1 through 3. It says, "Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended His work which He had made, and He rested on the seventh day from all His work which He had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it He had rested from all His work which God created and made." Now, it doesn't say simply that God rested on the Sabbath. If it had simply said God rested on the Sabbath, people might have taken that and said, well, the Sabbath is the first day of the week. Or the Sabbath can be any day of the week. I picked up a gentleman who was hitchhiking recently, and he seemed like he was quite a Bible scholar to listen to him. And he was talking about cults. Cults, like Mormons were cults, Jehovah's Witnesses were cults, Seventh-day Adventists were they were cults. I said, well, what makes up a cult? Well, he didn't seem to really know, but he seemed to know what they were. And I said, one thing that maybe you can help me with, since you're so intelligent on the Bible, is that the Bible says the seventh day is the Sabbath. That's what the King James Bible says. You use the King James Bible? Oh, yes, I use the King James only Bible. I said, well, the King James Bible says 7 days is the Sabbath. So where in the King James Bible does it say that we can now keep the first day of the week or Sunday? Or where does it say the Sabbath was changed? Well, of course, there is no change, is there? Because God doesn't change. But as we worship on the Sabbath, we acknowledge God as our creator and as worthy of worship. And the fourth commandment of the Decalogue gives us the reason for worshiping on the seventh day Sabbath. And let's turn to Exodus 20 now. In verse 11, it says, "For, or because, in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the," which day?
Seventh.
Which day?
Seventh.
The seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. But which day did he bless in Genesis? The seventh day. Here it says he blessed the Sabbath day. Which day is the Sabbath day? It's the seventh day. Not so hard, is it? It's not so hard. We, friends, are to worship God and acknowledge his great creative ability through the Sabbath. The need to present the Sabbath, though, in the light of the three angels' messages is important to understand. If I'm just presenting the Sabbath as Saturday instead of Sunday, this day instead of that day, it loses a great amount of its force and vitality. In fact, let me just share with you a statement here. This is from Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 337, but it says it really well. She speaks about an Elder K, and she says, "Elder K knows not of what spirit he is. He is uniting his influence with the dragon host to oppose those who keep the commandments of God and who have the testimony of Jesus. He has a hard warfare before him. As far as the Sabbath is concerned, he occupies the same position as the Seventh-day Baptist." Now, let me just pause for a minute. You know, there's a group called Seventh-day Baptist. And they're a lot like other Baptists, like Free Will Baptists. They're Armenian in thought, mostly, from Salvation Point. But he says there that this particular person is promoting something about like they do. And he doesn't know what he's doing. Now, I'd like to remind you that when the Seventh-day Adventist people began, they were a very, very small group, and Seventh-day Baptists were a relatively large group at that time. But today, there's almost no Seventh-day Baptists. They've almost totally went into existence, just a remnant of a few thousand left in the whole world. Mm-hmm. But notice what she says, continuing. She says, "Separate the Sabbath from the messages," and she's referring to the three angels' messages. "Separate the Sabbath from the messages and it loses its power, but when connected with the message of the third angel, a power attends it which convicts unbelievers and infidels and brings them out with strength to stand, to live, grow, and flourish in the Lord." It's interesting because in the first angel's message, you have the call to worship God as the creator. But here she specifically says that when we connect it with the third angel, and the issue of the third angel is about what? The mark of the beast. The mark of the beast. You see. Because the book of Revelation sets the seal of God in contradistinction to the mark of the beast. You see. And so when we preach the seventh day Sabbath in that connection, that God is the creator, and through him we have salvation as a creator, and the beast power tries to take that away and take away the symbol of that salvation, the Sabbath, from us. Friends, God created myriads of stars and planets and billions upon billions of galaxies by simply speaking them into existence. The Hubble Space Telescope has given us wonderful glimpses into the artistic, resourceful, and imaginative work of God. But creating myriads of beautiful galaxies and nebula is not the greatest miracle of God's creative ability. We have been told that the conversion of a sinner is the greatest of all miracles. In fact, in Manuscript Release, Volume 4, page 113, she says, "Brethren, the greatest miracle that can be wrought is the conversion of the human heart." And you know how that miracle occurs? It occurs by creation. It occurs by creation. God wants to give his children a new heart. We all have what the Bible says in Ezekiel, a stony heart. a stony heart. But God wants to change this to a heart of flesh in Ezekiel 36 and verse 26. He says, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh." He's going to give us a new heart, friends, a new heart, a heart that is a life or that is a flesh. And we are told that this is necessary because in Leviticus 17:11, the Bible says the life of the flesh is in the blood, and the heart's what pumps that blood around. Without the life-giving blood moving about our bodies, friends, we cannot live. A heart made of stone, well, it can't squeeze. It can't pump blood, can it? It can't pump spiritual life to us, as it were. A stony heart would break before it could be squeezed. But friends, we need a spiritual heart, a heart of flesh, to give us a spiritual life, because our stony hearts cannot bring life. The new covenant experience, however, has God's law written in the hearts of flesh, Jeremiah 31:34, and this brings life and health to the soul. And the getting of a new heart, friends, is a creative process. In Psalms 51, David, in his great prayer of penitence, he said in verse 10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." He didn't say, "Fix my heart." He said, "Do what?" He says, "Create me a clean heart. Create me a clean heart." In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, he says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." And what is it, friends, that is the sign of God's ability to create not only physical worlds, but new hearts? It is the seventh day Sabbath.
Amen.
In Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12, he says, "It is a sign between me and you that I am the Lord that sanctify you." And so today, we're going to have a group, not today, but in a couple of days, we're going to have a group of people meeting in Kansas City. And they're all going to be worshiping and adoring Sunday. And they're going to be telling you that if you keep that old Sabbath, that's a type of legalism. That's a type of works. Friends, it is the seventh day Sabbath that is a sign of righteousness by faith.
Amen.
And Sunday is a work and a devising of man's hands and man's ways.
Yep.
Today, I want the Lord in my life. I want Him to create me a clean heart. And I want to observe His Sabbath and walk in obedience to His commandments. Well, last week we were a little short because, as some of you know, there was a literature pass out planned in the afternoon, and it was at a time-sensitive situation meeting the people on the bridge at the New River Gorge. And I'm just really thankful to say that the Lord blessed us to hand out several tracts and have some nice meetings with people. Mm-hmm. And I'm thankful for that. And we don't have that time restriction upon us today, but that doesn't mean necessarily that I'm going to weary you with well-doing, I hope. But I do want to go back and just review a few things that we talked about last week. We've been talking about the first angel's message for several weeks now, and today may be the last week we talk about it for right now, but I assure you it doesn't exhaust the message at all. But we were looking at a quotation concerning the Sabbath, and I'd just like to review that quotation for just a minute. And this is found in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 337. Being in Volume 1 of the Testimonies, it tells you it's one of the earlier pieces of writing. Elder K knows not of what spirit he is. He is uniting his influence with the dragon host to oppose those who keep the commandments of God and who have the testimony of Jesus. He has a hard warfare before him. As far as the Sabbath is concerned, he occupies the same position as the Seventh-day Baptist. And then she makes this insightful comment. She says, "Separate the Sabbath from the messages and it loses its power. But when connected with the message of the third angel, a power attends it which convicts unbelievers and infidels and brings them out with strength to stand, to live, grow, and flourish in the Lord." Ellen White says that the Sabbath is to be connected with the message, and specifically the three angels' messages. Think about the way the Seventh-day Baptists taught the Sabbath. They didn't know the three angels' messages. They didn't understand the mark of the beast. And so the Sabbath was simply the correctness, if you please, of one day over another. Now, it's true, the Bible says the seventh day is the Sabbath. And that of itself should be enough to change anyone who's a sincere believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, that they should be worshiping on the seventh day instead of the first day. But it doesn't have the same force of power when we present it simply as one day being correct versus a day of incorrectness. When we take it outside of the scope of the large issue of the great controversy, then people don't get it. But when we present the Sabbath in light of the third angel's message, the issue of the papacy, the man of sin that has sought to change times and laws and has tried to, as it were, overthrow God, then it begins to have a power and a force for good, friends, that others cannot see and cannot understand. Now, also in connection with the message of the first angel, that we are to worship God as the Creator, and that's the beginning of this. This is the continuation of part four in this series called Worship Him. And we are told to worship Him who made all these things. And yet, as we noted in the last message, that our redemption is a creation process.
Amen.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth in 6 days. And on the seventh day, He rested. And He established what we call the Sabbath as a great memorial of His creative ability. And it was a designation of rest, not simply from physical work. Because if you'll think about it, if Adam and Eve had never sinned and had lived as temperately as they should have, and of course they would have been doing that if they had not sinned, they would have never needed the Sabbath for just physical rest. But it's because they needed the spiritual rest, they needed that time away from the day-by-day toil, even if it was a good toil, a light toil. They needed to have a special time to fix their minds to God. And we talk about today, we want to keep the Sabbath holy. We have a Fanny Crosby song, remember? Keep the Sabbath holy. Even though she was a Sunday keeper, she thought the Sunday was the Sabbath, right? But we sing the song, it's a good song. When we talk about keeping the Sabbath holy, friends, it should not be, in our minds, simply a checklist of do's and don'ts, you know, and if I get more of the do's and less of the don'ts, I'm okay today or whatever. Keeping the Sabbath holy, friends, means that we're keeping our time and our special relationship with God holy, that we're putting Him first throughout the day. The Sabbath isn't just about what I do and don't do, and I'm not negating the fact that there are things that we should do and things that we should not do on the Sabbath. But it's because there are things that we should and should not do in the presence of God when He's asking us for His special time. We don't just turn around and neglect. I was visiting someone a while back, and they were in the hospital, and this individual's had 2 daughters, and they were there, young daughters, and I tried to introduce myself to one of them, and they said, hello. That's okay, right? But they have their phone, right? And they're going, hello. Okay, my name is so-and-so, you know. And they're not even looking at me. Don't even make eye contact. And I said, you like that phone pretty good, don't you? Yeah. And just kept at it. Do you think God ever feels that way on the Sabbath with us? You know, we're busy. And that's why He tells us to make all these preparations ahead of time. To try to get your cooking set up. So that at most, all you have to do is warm something up in an easy way for Sabbath meals. So that you don't have to be worried about going and buying gasoline to drive to church. Of course, if you lived in some of those churches in Eastern Europe and you remember the Reformed Church, it's a sin to drive your church. To drive the church. You can't drive the church. You have to walk. And that's because driving is wrong, they say. So what the members do, they drive within about 2 blocks of the church and then they get out and walk. Because they don't want people to think they're breaking the Sabbath. You know, hypocrites. But the Sabbath, friends, it is the golden clasp that binds our hearts to God.
Amen.
And it's not just one day or another. It's a sign of righteousness by faith as well. Now, I mentioned some of these texts last week. We talked about Ephesians 2, Jeremiah 31, Psalms 51, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. That the redemption that we have is a creative process, see? And the Sabbath is a memorial of God's creation, not only of the physical creation, but the spiritual recreation in us, the new clean heart. And so that's why we need the Sabbath so much. Now, I begin this series by giving you some of the history this message based upon the spirit of prophecy, because I believe it's the most accurate historical record that we have. Okay? And I want to finish the first angel's message with a little bit of what the spirit of prophecy says also about the work and the scope of this first angel and how it's going to have its effect. Now, even though we've spent 5-6 weeks speaking on the first angel's message, we have not by any means exhausted this study. I can assure you that this is a very broad and sweeping message in its scope. It's the message that involves salvation from sin. It involves the message of justification, sanctification, and finally glorification. And the different parts of the first angel's message, they interlock like the pieces of a puzzle to create a beautiful picture of God's plan for humanity. The judgment bar is set before all men. But you know, friends, before you can go into court and face judgment, there has to be a standard for the judgment. Isn't that right? And what is the standard of the judgment in God's court? It is the Ten Commandments, friends. And this is one reason that Satan so desperately wants to destroy the Ten Commandments from the people's view. He wants to take the Sabbath, the sign of their sanctification, the sign of their righteousness by faith, away from them. Because when you do away with that, it's pretty hard to have a judgment. It's hard to stand in judgment then before God, because there is no standard of the judgment. And again, he especially would like to take this testing truth of the fourth commandment away from us. And we've been told that the Sabbath is a safeguard against evolution. I was shown that if the true Sabbath had been kept, there would never have been an infidel or an atheist. The observance of the Sabbath would have preserved the world from idolatry. There would be no evolution taught today, friends, if the true Sabbath had always been kept. There would be no infidels, no idolaters. Properly observed and understood, the Sabbath is a sign of righteousness by faith. It's not a works program, as so many Sunday keepers claim. In fact, Sunday worship, being an act of man and not of God, is actually the sign of righteousness by works among Christians. Or any false teaching apart from the true Sabbath, like lunar Sabbath keeping, is actually a sign of righteousness by works. The first angel's message, friends, it calls for God's people to be obedient and self-sacrificing in giving glory to Him. The first angel's message, combined with the second and the third angel's messages, teaches that it would be better, friends, to die than to willingly break one of God's commandments. Why do you say that? Because, friends, in the issue of the mark of the beast, people are going to have to make decisions. And the ultimate decision is whether we're going to obey God or not. And the people who are willing to obey God are going to make a decision that they will rather die, because that is what they will be faced with, a death penalty, if they do not accept the mark of the beast. And if they're going to keep the seal of God, if they're going to be obedient to God, then they must be willing to die for that. The first angel's message also teaches a reverence to God that will safeguard the church from celebration or Pentecostal type worship that's based upon emotions and not the sure word of God. As one carefully considers the truth of the first angel's message, we can see, friends, that it's not a popular message. It's a message that is opposite of the message which sells comfort to most people. A comfort of being at ease in your sins as you are now, not worrying about making changes. The giving of this message, friends, will either warn and separate people from their sin or allow them to have a chance to stifle their consciences into a lukewarm state that cannot be helped. We were told in the book, The Great Controversy, the first angel's message of Revelation 14, announcing the hour of God's judgment and calling upon men to fear and worship Him, was designed to separate the professed people of God from the corrupting influences of the world and to arouse them to see their true condition of worldliness and backsliding. Now, it doesn't take a theologian, it doesn't take an advanced student to know that the second angel's message, combined with the fourth angel's message, is a separating message, right? Clearly, it's a separating message. And I think if we know what the third angel's message is, you know it's a separating message. But sometimes people don't understand that the first angel's message is also a separating message. And it's designed to separate the church from the corrupting influences of the world. Great Controversy 398. The preaching of the first angel's message and of the midnight cry tended directly to repress fanaticism and dissension. Those who participated in these solemn movements were in harmony. Their hearts were filled with love for one another and for Jesus, whom they expected soon to see. The one faith, the one blessed hope, lifted them above the controls of any human influence and proved a shield against the assaults of Satan. And so if we would listen to the first angel's message, friends, it serves as a shield against the assaults of Satan. The first angel's message was so complete that Ellen White wrote that if it were accepted, it would restore the people, the church, to an apostolic state and to the perfection that God calls his people to obtain. And I do have that statement here. I believe it's right here in Great Controversy, page 379. It says, God has sent to the church a warning, which, had it been accepted, would have corrected the evils that were shutting them away from him. Had they received the message from heaven, humbling their hearts before the Lord and seeking in sincerity a preparation to stand in his presence, the spirit and power of God would have been manifested among them. And before I go on to the next part of the statement, I just want you to notice what it says at the beginning. It says, God had sent to the church a warning, which, had it been accepted, would have corrected the evils that were shutting them away from him. Is Sunday, this brainchild of the papacy, a good thing? Or is it an evil thing?
Evil.
Is it an evil thing to speak against the commandments of God and try to substitute one day for another? And what was the nature of almost all those believers as far as their day of worship before 1844? They were virtually all Sunday keepers. But the point of the Sabbath is that we have direct fellowship with God in a special, unique way that we don't get the rest of the week. And so this was to help bring them away from that situation into a more direct line with God, if it was accepted. She continues, the church would again have reached that blessed state of unity, faith, and love which existed in apostolic days when the believers were of one heart and of one soul and spake the word of God with boldness when the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Is it any wonder then that this message is portrayed as being given with a loud voice? In fact, we are told in the book Last Day Events, page 201, this message, referring to the message of Revelation chapter 14 through 12 there, it says, embraces the two preceding messages. This message, Revelation 14, 12, here they keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, embraces the two preceding messages. It is represented as being given with a loud voice, that is, with the power of the Holy Spirit. So here we have a message, friends, that will separate us from the corrupting influences of the world. Here's a message that will restore us to the kind of fellowship with God that we need, and the church to a state of unity and faith and love such as they had in apostolic days. This is a message then. This is a message that should engage our interests, shouldn't it? It should consume us, beloved. Now today is Saturday, by common terms. And in about 20, 30 minutes or an hour or two, all across this country, up at West Virginia. We were up there at WVU. I was up at WVU twice this week at the Ruby Memorial Hospital, which happens to be just across a big parking lot from the West Virginia University football stadium. And they're having a game there. It's hard to avoid knowing it if you're up there. They're having a game this week against someone. I saw the team, but I don't remember. But they're having a game there this week, and they're getting all the preparations made. And they're going to have about 50 or 60,000 people come to that stadium for that game. And that's just little West Virginia. You know, in Texas and in Florida and these football mega places, they're going to have several universities having 70, 80, 100,000 people. Michigan, they have 100,000 people in a stadium in Michigan for a football game. And these people are going to come there, and they're going to cheer like idiots and fanatics. And they are fanatics. A fan is just a short word for fanatic, you know. It is. It's just an abbreviated word. And their minds are going to be far from God, friends. Their hearts are far from God. But I want to tell you that angels are interested in the message, and they work tirelessly day and night for its giving. Someone asked me a question, or somehow I come to this thought in my mind the other day. I don't know the name of my guardian angel. Do you? I just never thought that I about knowing his name, but he has a name, I'm sure. I don't know his name. I'd like to know, and I believe someday I will know. But I want to tell you, he works tirelessly to try to push me, to nudge me, to get me to give the message more, and to do more, and to be more interested, more zealous. Because that's what we need. And concerning this message, Ellen White said, concerning the giving of the message before 1844, that, and I'm quoting to you from early writings, page 235. I do have the slide here. It says, angels were watching with the deepest interest the results of the heavenly message. They had the deepest interest. Not just a deep interest, but the deepest interest. Do you think that this message is sacred and a solemn message? Sister Anika was telling a story in Sabbath school class about someone who had some writings of, was it a Chinese philosopher or something? And they had kept these writings in a chest, and they opened the chest, and they took this out, and it was wrapped in a nice silk scarf of some kind. And, you know, this is a sacred book. Friends, I want to tell you the message of Revelation 14, 6 through 12 is a sacred, solemn message for us. And we've been told in the testimonies on volume 9, page 19, that in a special sense, Seventh-day Adventists have been set in the world as watchmen and light bearers. To them has been entrusted the last warning for a perishing world. On them is shining wonderful light from the Word of God. They have been given a work of the most what?
Solemn
import, the proclamation of the first, second, and third angels' messages. There is another work of so great importance. They are to allow nothing else to absorb their attention. She says, the most solemn truths ever entrusted to mortals have been given us to proclaim to the world. The proclamation of these truths is to be our work. The world is to be warned, and God's people are to be true to the trust committed to them. What is the greatest crime that a person can commit?
Treason.
Treason is the worst of all crimes. Luther said that lying was worse than murder. So lying is worse than murder. This is because you can deceive so many more people. You can change people's salvation so much. He says you murder someone, if they're saved, it doesn't matter. You know? But friends, when you perform treason, you endanger a whole nation. And when you perform treason against God, you endanger the whole church. And there are going to be men who are going to stand in the judgment bar of God, and they're going to have to answer for the things that they have taught and promulgated in God's church. Don't think for a minute they won't. And this is a sacred work. Friends, we have this message. It's sacred. It should help us to understand just how important our message is, to know that it is a sacred message. And friends, you know, I say this humbly, but no one else in the world has this but the Adventist people. And most of the Adventist people are trying to throw it into the historical trash can. Giving the three angels' messages, friends, is a solemn work, and it is also a sacred work. Interestingly, in the book Counsels on Diets and Foods, because we know that the health message is important, but she says the most solemn, sacred work ever given to mortals is the proclamation of the first, second, and third angels' messages to our world. So it's not only a solemn work, but it is a sacred work. In Great Controversy, page 355, she says the fact that an angel is said to be the herald of this warning is significant. By the purity, the glory, and the power of the heavenly messenger, divine wisdom has been pleased to represent the exalted character of the work to be accomplished by the message and the power and glory that were to attend it. Great Controversy, page 355. So friends, when you're busy giving the first angel's message, you're giving a message that has purity, glory, and it is of an exalted character. In the three angels' messages, we find then solemn, sacred, and exalted. And only the selfish heart of man would reject such love as is being offered. You know, you think about the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. These things that seemingly have such attractive drawing power for people. The physical draw of nicotine, the physical draw of alcohol, the physical draw of the opiates that so many people are using today. And they do have a terribly strong pull. There's no question about that. But friends, if we could understand the great love of Jesus, the love of God in giving his son better, as Jesus said in John chapter 12, verse 32, he says, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. He'll draw all unto him. And it is, I'm sorry to say, to a great degree, my lack and maybe our lack of being able to present the gospel in its purity, sacredness, loveliness, that is allowing so many people to still swim in their sins of habits and defilements. But I believe, friends, that this message is more beautiful than anything the world offers. And I believe Christ is more beautiful than Satan. And I believe his power is greater than that of Satan. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, 1 John 4:4. Why did men reject the message in 1844? What results occur when men reject the message? Sadly, most of the people who heard the first angel's message rejected it. As the churches rejected the message, they fell from the favor of God, and they received the frown of Jesus. And that's right. Jesus sometimes frowns. Notice the inspired history of that moment in early writings, page 237. As the churches refused to receive the first angel's message, they rejected the light from heaven and fell from the favor of God. They trusted to their own strength, and by opposing the first message, placed themselves where they could not see the light of the second angel's message. But the beloved of God who were opposed accepted the message. Babylon has fallen and left the churches. You think, friends, you think that we give the second angel's message. You think that we're not afraid to give the second angel's message. But I want to tell you, there are people even in this Truth About God movement that are awful quiet about the second angel's message. And you really want to know really why? It's because they have not had the first angel's message deep in their hearts yet. Because if we've really accepted the first angel's message and we understand it and we've applied it, friends, then the second angel's message comes naturally. It's easy. It's part of the message. She says, those who rejected and opposed the light of the first angel's message lost the light of the second and could not be benefited by the power and glory which attended the message. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Jesus turned from them with a frown, for they had slighted and rejected him. And when we reject the second angel's message, or any of the messages, friends, it's a rejection, a type of rejection of Christ. When we reject a message from Jesus, we are rejecting himself in the form of that message. Do you remember what God told Samuel when he felt that the people rejected him when asking for a king? In 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 7, and the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. In fact, Ellen White goes on to say in early writings, page 260, many look with horror at the course of the Jews in rejecting and crucifying Christ. And as they read the history of his shameful abuse, they think they love him and would not have denied him as did Peter or crucified him as did the Jews. But God, who reads the hearts of all, has brought to the test that love for Jesus which they professed to feel. All heaven watched with the deepest interest the reception of the first angel's message. But many who professed to love Jesus and who shed tears as they read the story of the cross derided the good news of his coming. Instead of receiving the message with gladness, they declared it to be a delusion. Let me just pause there. People that would read Matthew 27, they would read these texts about Jesus going to die for them, and they'd cry. But then they would hear the message of the first angel, and instead of receiving it, they would declare it to be a delusion, friends. She says, they hated those who loved his appearing and shut them out of the churches. Those who rejected the first message could not be benefited by the second, neither were they benefited by the midnight cry, which was to prepare them to enter with Jesus by faith into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And by rejecting the two former messages, they have so darkened their understanding that they can see no light in the third angel's message, which shows the way into the most holy place. Now, friends, our work. As I read from Volume 9 earlier, God has given us a work to do. It's a solemn work. It's a sacred work. And it's a work of an exalted character. We are to intellectually and with seriousness and solemnity share the judgment hour message. Because, friends, these are, and I assure you, these are life and death issues. This is what everything is going to come down to in the end. You know, we see all kinds of things happening in our world today. You know, are we going to go to war with North Korea? Is there going to be a nuclear holocaust? People are worried. How are we going to fix this gender issue that's going on among us? And now, you know, we have all the sexual harassment issues of society. Well, don't get me wrong. You know, those things are not unimportant. They're very important to the people that they affect. That's fine. But those aren't going to be the final death and life issues that the three angels' message is going to be based on. It's going to be based upon whether we're going to keep the commandments of God, especially the fourth commandment, or not. And that fourth commandment is going to be the test that reveals whether we're going to be faithful to God's commandments. This is a solemn message. It's life and death. And death, friends, is a solemn matter. But the judgment is more solemn. Because death will only separate us from friends for just a period of time. But the judgment is going to separate people for eternity. Beloved, you may not feel educated. You may not feel qualified to give the message. And while we wish to be intelligent in what we are doing, we should remember where we are and do all in our power to share the message. But remember that success does not depend upon your intellect or your power. According to Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 6, then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. That's where our unction, that's where our power comes from. You know, it doesn't mean we don't use all the tools that are availability. You know, I do writing, and I really wasn't trained to be a professional writer, so I have to rely upon a lot of books and help and other people, you know, to help me with proofreading and getting, you know, the T's crossed and the I's dotted and things. And I don't know why I did this too, you know. They say she had a third grade education. And the fact is, when you look at her original manuscripts, sometimes that becomes evident almost. But she was able to get these things polished up and in the best words that express what she was really saying, and it was beautiful, see. But God says it's by his spirit that these things are going to go. And in the vision of God that Ezekiel had, he saw hands under the wings of the living creatures of the cherubim. That's in Ezekiel 1:8. Remember that, the visions of God that Ezekiel had, we read about in chapter 1? What do those hands represent? I don't want to tell you what they represent. She says, this is to teach his servants that it is divine power which gives them success. Thoughts from the Mount of Blessing, page 121. That's what we need today, friends. We need not to depend or to rely upon our own goodness, our own intelligence, our own learning to see the message go forward. We need to depend upon the Lord of hosts and understand that it is divine power that will give us success. in preaching and presenting the first angel's message. And may I say, not only the first, but the second, the third, and yes, the fourth also. May God bless us, friends, to put sin out of our lives so that we can receive His Spirit, so that His Spirit can work in our lives. And that's my appeal to you today, to understand the solemnity of this message, the sacredness of this message, the exalted character of it, and to have a life that is in correspondence with that and depend upon divine power so that we too can give this message and give it in its fullness, because time is almost over. May God bless each one. Lots and lots.